On tonight's Gwinnett Prep Rally, region races start to hit the gas. In Region 8, Shiloh comes off a huge win, but are they up to rumbling in the jungle? Find out. Collins Hill could make a statement win against neighborhood bully North, but have the dogs got too much fight? GPR barely recognizes the Duluth program these days, but Norcross knows them all too well. Who'd get the W? And Buford highlights are so boring that we thought we'd feature one of their big guys instead. So join us for throwdowns, comebacks, and good times on GPR right now.
For more than 15 years, your source for Gwinnett County sports is Gwinnett Prep Rally.
Hello again, and welcome to your county's original high school sports television program. This is Gwinnett Prep Rally now in its 19th season, and we'll be here on GCPS for the entire 2011-2012 school year. I'm Todd Klein alongside Will Hammack from the Gwinnett Daily Post. And Will, the 2011 Gwinnett County Cross Country Championships took place this past weekend in Duluth, and there were some familiar teams and individuals taking home the top honors.
Yeah, the Brookwood Cross Country teams dominated once again. I mean, that's something we got to really talk about every year when you talk about the county meet. They're very impressive teams. Dominate when it comes to this level, and I think this is a team that's going to do a lot at the state meet. You have Morgan Malinowski, who did great. Josh Burkell here from Peachtree Ridge won the individual title. He's a great runner. The girls' race was interesting. Chloe Whitworth won a battle there with Catherine Yost of Norcross. Lauren Kelly from Peachtree Ridge, she also had a great race. So it was very competitive, the girls' race. I think when it comes down to it, you're seeing the best runners in the state of Georgia when you talk about this meet. Probably a preview of what's going to happen at the state meet in Carrollton in a few weeks.
Well, our special thanks to the Gwinnett Daily Post for those photos. Well, let's get right to the football highlights, and we start off with a neighborhood rivalry as North Gwinnett made it the short drive to Collins Hill for an important Region 7 battle. GPR's Nathan Shutter has more.
Collins Hill hosting North Gwinnett in the Battle of Suwanee. First quarter, Eagles looking to take the early lead. Mitchell Blanchard on for the field goal attempt, and he knocks it through from 40 yards. Collins Hill up 3-0. Second quarter, North would have an answer. Joe Jones on the draw play. He battles his way in for the touchdown. Bulldogs take a 7-3 lead. Following a Collins Hill turnover, North back on offense. Scott Hoche launching the pass downfield, and he connects with Nate Brown for a big gain down inside the 5-yard line. And Jones would do the rest from there, keeping the legs churning to get into the end zone for 6. North Gwinnett up 14-3. Collins Hill would have an answer on their next drive. Bradley Johnson going downfield to Tevin Holiday. He makes the leaping grab to move the chains into North territory. Then more from the passing game. Johnson pump fakes and launches it deep. Nick England makes the diving catch along the sideline for Collins Hill. And the Eagles would capitalize. Johnson dumps it off to Tyler Henderson. He jukes the defender, but the ball is stripped at the goal line. Tevin Holiday is Johnny on the spot as he recovers in the end zone for the touchdown. Collins Hill down 14-10. North back on offense. Scott Hoche hands it off to Joe Jones, and he's running hard for the big gain down inside the 5-yard line. And he would be rewarded as Jones plunges into the end zone from a yard out. PAT was no good. Bulldogs up 20-10 at the break. Second half, North with the ball. Hoche going up top to the end zone, and Chad Scott makes the grab for 6. Bulldogs in control, up 27-10. Collins Hill looking to answer on offense, but the North D was not complying. Justin Alabi with the sack, and the Eagles' drive would stall. North Gwinnett would take over on offense, and Hoosh hands it off to Donnie Miles. He goes untouched from 15 yards out for the touchdown. Bulldogs up 34-10. Fourth quarter now, Collins Hill trying to rally. Johnson looking to go downfield, and he's going to be picked off by Malcolm Jackson to seal the game for the Bulldogs as North Gwinnett defeats Collins Hill by a final of 34-10.
Well, Will, Collins Hill is struggling right now, but North Gwinnett is doing anything but.
Yeah, North Gwinnett's rolling right along. It's clearly emerging as the favorite in that region. I think Norcross is pretty good too, but I think North Gwinnett's probably the favorite, playing great on offense right now. Scotty Hoche is as good as any quarterback in Gwinnett County. He's proven it. And they've also developed a pretty good running game to balance it out. So very strong on offense, and you know they're going to be very competitive, very fast on defense.
Well, the Shiloh Generals picked up a surprising road victory over South Gwinnett for their first win of the season, and they were trying to make it 2 in a row as they went on the road to take on Parkview at the Big Orange Jungle. GPR's Jeff Batten has all the action.
Shiloh travels to the Big Orange Jungle to take on the Panthers, and after the Panthers fumble and 75 yards through the air, Fred Mooring punches it in, giving the Generals a 7-0 lead to open the second quarter. So let's go to the third quarter. Panthers leading 8-7. Chris Carson looks to be denied the third down conversion, but a Shiloh penalty extends the drive. Later, it's Carson again, a huge hole to run through, and just like that, it's first and goal Parkview. Chris Carson gets the call again, this time taking it in for the score, and the Panthers take a 16-7 lead. Later in the third, Parkview sticking with the ground game, Carson marches down to the Generals 22, and with another offensive line surge, the Panthers are deep in the red zone. Once again, it's Carson on the call, but the Generals are able to hold him at the goal line. But that would just delay the inevitable as Carson slams in from the three, and after a two-point conversion, they lead it 23-7. Later, Shiloh gets things going as Devontae James finds Matthew Moore for a general first down. Fourth quarter, Shiloh still on the move as Brandon Wise takes the handoff, moving the Generals deep into Panther territory. Shiloh tries to punch it in at the goal line, but the Parkview D holds the Generals to fourth and goal. That's when Devontae James hits Stephen Weatherly on a slant for the touchdown, but it's too late for a comeback. Parkview gets their first win of the year, knocking off Shiloh 30-13.
Well, a special thanks goes out to the Shiloh Touchdown Club for those highlights, Will. But those highlights look really good for that Parkview running game.
Yeah, Parkview's starting to run the ball better. I think as a team starting to come around, they went 0-2, but lost to some very good teams. Norcross and Stevenson were very strong teams. So I think Parkview's going to be a force in this region, and I think Shiloh's a much improved team. The score maybe didn't show it, but they've got some playmakers over there. Donald Clark's going to be one of the best players in the county.
Well, more highlights now in a battle between two high-powered offenses as Norcross played host to Duluth in a pivotal Region 7 clash. Nathan Shutter has the call.
Head coach Keith Maloof and the Norcross Blue Devils taking on the Wildcats of Duluth. We pick this one up with the Wildcats driving third quarter down 21-7. Duluth quarterback Anthony Stewart completes a pass over the middle to senior wideout Nick Whitaker to move the chains. Later on in the drive, Stewart drops back to pass, gets flushed out of the pocket by the Blue Devil defense, throws on the run, and that one is nearly picked off by linebacker Tommy Tate. That would set up a 36-yard field goal attempt by Duluth kicker Caleb Starvosnik, which misses wide to the left. Wildcats would get the ball back and make the most of this drive. Stewart drops back and completes a pass to number 14 Lavelle Lawton, who takes the ball all the way down to the one. That would set up Matthew Randall from 1 yard out, cutting the Blue Devil lead in half 21-14. Norcross would look to answer on their next possession as Joseph Wilbur completes a pass out into the flat to Jason Kroon, who then refuses to be taken down, breaking not one, but two tackles before finally being brought down by two Wildcat defenders. Kroon would finish the game with 83 yards on three receptions and a couple of touchdowns. A few plays later, the Blue Devils would finish the drive on a short touchdown run by Alvin Kamara, extending their lead to 28-14. On the ensuing drive, the Wildcats would seal their fate with this deflected pass intercepted by Jaquan Simpkins, who returns the ball deep into Duluth territory. That was Stewart's second interception of the game. Alvin Kamara and the Blue Devils would go on to add one more touchdown, winning this one 35-14 and improving to 4-0 overall and 1-0 in the region.
Well, a big win there for Norcross, Will, but the headlines after this game were the big injuries to both teams.
Yeah, it was a tough loss for both teams. I think Anthony Stewart's high ankle sprain, you never want those. It's really hurting Duluth to lose a quarterback like that. That may keep him out a few weeks, and even worse news for Norcross, Tanner Maloof tearing up his knee in that one. It's going to keep him out for a while, so just a very sad day for them, and a lot of turnovers, a very sloppy game, two very good offenses that really couldn't get out of their own way this week, but Norcross has the better defense, and they did enough to win this ballgame.
Well, time now to recap other football action from this past Friday night. It's brought to you by Nexstar Communication, and we start off with a huge win by the Mountain View Bears.
Yeah, easily the biggest win in Mountain View history to knock off Mill Creek, and a lot of those kids know each other because Mountain View took a lot of students from Mill Creek when it opened. A great win for those guys. Tyler Bethune played great on defense. Chris Bartlett, a very efficient day running that offense. 13 of 17, 142 yards passing, so a great win for that program. Really showed that they've arrived.
And I tell you what, Will, if you liked offense, you loved this game at the Georgia Dome between South Gwinnett and Central, with South Gwinnett getting a much-needed win.
Yeah, I think if the two basketball teams played right now, they might not match the score. It's pretty crazy, 63-55. Central, if not for the turnovers, maybe could have scored 80 points in this game. Really, their own worst enemy. I thought they might win this game, but credit South. They made plays to pull it out.
And then we go to your alma mater, Brookwood. They beat Archer, but I think this game has more people talking about Archer than Brookwood.
Yeah, much like Mountain View, Archer's kind of arrived too. They beat Mountain View head-to-head, and Archer's got a pretty good football team. Surprisingly physical for a young program, and it came down to the end. They cut into this lead, and Brookwood had to recover an offside or onside kick. Afolobi Laguda recovering that onside kick just kind of saved the day for the Broncos there late.
And I guess my question there, Will, is how are the Broncos going to do the rest of the season? They had the loss to Tequila. They have a scare to Archer. Do they get things going right, or are there bigger problems than maybe people think?
Yeah, they need to straighten things out. I think defensively they're going to be okay. Offensively, they really got to move the ball. You wonder with those two running backs how they're not moving the ball. I think the quarterback's played pretty well. I think offensively it starts up front. They really got to get that offensive line together and gelling and playing Brookwood football along the line. If they do that, they can definitely turn the season around.
All right, when we come back, we'll sit down with Buford superstar Dylan Lee in this week's team leader segment. Plus, we'll get in the mind of our very own Will Hammack, and we'll also unveil this week's building blocks. You're watching Gwinnett Prep Rally on GCPS-TV. For 19 years, the county's high school sports television program.
For two decades, Colder Sports has been making dreams possible for thousands of Gwinnett County student-athletes.
Sometimes we've been over the top.
Thrill is gone.
Steve Colder sings.
And the leader of the clan will take no prisoners on this day.
Sometimes we've been straight to the point.
Beverly Coulter is the most persuasive sporting goods salesman in Gwinnett County history, and that's including your son, Steve.
But most of all, we've cared deeply about every Gwinnett parent and student who walked through this front door.
Over all these years,
we thank you for your support.